Good morning, everybody. You are tuned to Computers 2K Now on the Nissan Communications Network. I'm Amnon, your host for the next 2 hours, along with Steve.
Hello, everybody.
Good morning. And Nick is here.
Hey, good morning.
Good morning. Our number is 919-518-9773, Computers 2K Voice on Skype. And this morning's show is being brought to you by Atomos.com, makers of quality video recorders and converters for professionals. And the broadcast is also made possible by Telestream's Wirecast software. What a week!
That was the week that was.
To some people, a week from heaven. To others, a week from hell. But it's amazing. I don't think I've ever experienced this since I've been
Didn't
here, since 73.
Coming. Didn't see that one coming.
No. But hopefully everything is subsiding and slowing down. Morning, Andrew. Good morning. Jorvik is in the chat. What do you know? John, Paul, Arnie, Alan, Peter. I thought Marl said that he cannot be. Maybe it's just the ghost of Marl in the chat. But, yeah, that was some week. I mean, did you guys see any ripple effects of all this in the UK, Steve?
Yeah, I mean, I didn't follow a huge amount of it because I don't follow politics much, but a lot of it happened for us in the morning, so the majority of people were in bed unless you were following it and needed to for any reason. One thing that did come to light that somebody mentioned, in fact, Jorvik mentioned to me in the week, was that most people's stock markets went down. Ours went up in the UK, apparently.
Yeah, it went down. The futures went down big time.
But ours went up
at night. But the next day, it was
strange.
A record high. So, yeah.
As we said in the week, it's early days yet. We'll have to wait
right,
and see.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
But there'll be lots of speculation and guessing. We'll know, you know, in when it happens. That's it.
Yeah. And it like that's what I'm saying. It'll slow down, sort itself out, and everything will be back to normal. Everybody will be back to what they're doing every day. And
well, let's hope, as he hopes, that they can get together, work together, in unison, and you know, produce a better America.
Hopefully.
And in turn, a better world, hopefully.
Yeah, because, I mean, forget it. I couldn't go to Canada now because their website broke down, so.
It crashed.
Yeah, it crashed. But that's what happened when you run a website on a 386 with 256K bandwidth. You know.
Yeah, and 16 megabytes of RAM.
Yeah. What 16? 16 megabytes. Megabyte, not gigabyte.
Yeah, megabytes of RAM, yeah.
Yeah. Well, let's see what is happening on that has to do with that. It's a concerned over the spread of fake news on the social networking giant Facebook. U.S. President Barack Obama has criticized Facebook, saying fake stories on social networks are spreading lies this election. Speaking at a rally for Hillary Clinton at the University of Michigan, Obama said, "The way campaigns have unfolded, we just start accepting crazy stuff as normal, and people, if they just repeat attacks enough, and outright lies over and over again. As long as it's on Facebook and people can see it, as long as it's on social media, people start believing it. And it creates this dust cloud of nonsense." A recent BuzzFeed investigation found that 38% of posts shared from three large right-wing politics pages on Facebook included false or misleading information. I would like, I mean, my opinion, and I'm not big on social media, both sides had all kind of stories and rumors and lies. And I mean, there were, because you'll always find people. Remember, these are people that are sitting there and they like to believe, and they like to talk about what they believe in. And just like today when the Democrats are on media are grabbing at every little thing they can grab on to show, no, we were right. It's the same thing, I guess, when things are happening over there. Social media, I mean, they, this is what we always say. So you believe everything on the internet. You know, I mean, people don't believe the mainstream or cable news, because either it doesn't play to their beliefs, or everybody says that it's not true. They can't go by social media because it's too open. If you know how to read between the lines, though, and I believe this is where the Trump campaign excelled, then you can get some information out of social media. But you cannot just read it and say, okay, this is the gospel. All right, the Tuesday night watching TV, I mean, I couldn't take it anymore. I mean, I'm a Fox guy. But Fox is preaching to the choir. So I like to go and watch other networks. And it was up and down and up and down and up and down. I said, I'm going to go to sleep. I'll know in the morning. And do you think I went in the morning when I got up, I went to the TV to see Fox? No, I didn't. I went to our hangout and I looked at what Nick was writing and Andrew and others. And when I saw that everything was good, then I turned the TV on. But it's sort of like you looking at what's going on over there and you can't. Nick!
What?
Look at the shirt. Oh, shoot. I should have put mine.
Leave me alone. You're harassing me. It's a beautiful day in the United States of America.
Yes, it is. And let me tell you guys, Nick turned religious because the first word.
Yeah, it was like a day.
Yeah. The first thing he told me when he finally got up and I was up and we were talking, he said, "Bless you. Bless the USA." What's going on, Nick? But yeah, I mean, you can look at social media and you can read between the lines. You have to read between the lines. I know it's a cliche kind of, and with a grain, take it with a grain of salt and all that.
Well, I think there are a lot of technical things, technology wise, that we can look at for this election. specifically, I don't know. I mean, I don't want to talk. I don't know how far you want to go into this.
No, no. I mean, I won't talk about the technical part of it.
Yeah, I think a technical part of it is how in the 2020 election, how do these pollsters continue doing polling? It is clearly obvious that phone polling, calling someone's landline, is not a reliable way of polling anymore. People are cutting their cable, and when they cut their cable, they get rid of their home phone and they have cell phones. Yeah. And cell phones aren't being used for most of these polls. It's typical landlines. And that when you call people on landlines, the only people you typically have home are people that are unemployed or older people that are retired. It's not a good, I don't think it's a good sample size of the population. So what do we do going forward?
And not only that, but the longer we went, and the bigger the problems, people did not want to tell the truth. So well, what good I, is
not
a
even
poll?
That aside? I'm talking technically.
Yeah, I know, side. I understand. And doing that, somebody
even
has
an internet poll. It looks like the LA Times poll. It was pretty spot on.
Maybe they should ask them how they do it.
Well, the LA Times poll was just a regular like daily tracking poll, which there's a lot of controversy with those polls as well, because they have these huge swings which aren't realistic. And there's things that can be said for both of these types of polling. The first thing is these daily tracking polls, which is they allow 1,000 people onto the LA Times website. And those same 1,000 people are asked the same question every single day. Who are you voting for? That's the question every day. But the problem is, it's emotional because they're asking you every day. It's not a pollster that calls your house once. So there's issues and there's a big margin of error with those as well. So I don't know what the solution is, but something's got to change, because now it is obvious more than ever that calling somebody's landline is not a reliable way of polling for a presidential election.
All right. Yeah.
I mean, did you get polled? Do you live in a swing state? You're home all day.
I'm home all day, and we probably hit about maybe 10 calls for polling, and I would just hang up.
You got 10 calls for polling?
Probably. Yeah. I mean, really? there were people that were asking. I don't know from what side or from where or what.
Interesting. I wasn't aware of that.
Yeah. And I just kept on hanging up.
Interesting.
Because, I mean, again, it's I don't believe in what you're doing because you're not doing an honest job. And some people could have that I put in that pool may have been trying to do an honest job and I hindered it. I don't know. But I think a lot of people did. And it's just the nature of the beast.
Yeah. And unfortunately, me not living in a swing state, you know, the polling is far and few in between. There was maybe 4 or 5 polls the entire time, which is fine.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I think when you're calling landlines, you're really limiting yourself to. Typically, it's an older population. And if I moved out today, if I moved into an apartment today, I would 100% not get a landline.
Right. I mean,
100%. It's too expensive. There's no way I would spend $25 a month on a landline when I'm already spending $30 just for cell phone service.
25 is nice.
A bundle with cable, actually. I think that's what it is, or something. Oh, that's before all the FCC taxes.
They were.
But I don't know.
Yeah.
Something's got to change with that.
Or let the chips fall where they may. I mean, what did they do before social media came about?
Well, that's an interesting point. Can you do poll? Does, and this is the big question. This is what everybody's analyzing, and this is what I'm analyzing as well. What effect, if any, did social media presence have to do with this election? You cannot disagree that Donald Trump had the best social media presence out of both of the candidates. He was far more popular on Facebook, far more popular on Twitter, and far more popular on Facebook Live when his rallies were being broadcast.
And YouTube.
But the question is, did that actually have an effect, or was it just a coincidence that he had that as well? That's the question. Maybe there's somebody, no way to know, unfortunately. Yeah, maybe you can't redo the election without it.
Maybe somebody will come up with an answer afterwards.
Well, there is really no way to know. But that's very interesting for a 2020 or a 2024 election is having a large social media presence
important,
beneficial? Yeah. Does rally size matter? Does, 100,000 people watching a Facebook Live matter?
I'm sure nobody knows. I'm sure it matters.
I mean, that's the big question. We really don't know if it mattered or not. I'd like to think it does, but there's really no formula to put together that will give you that.
I was reading that apparently Trump's sort of poll figures and things were reasonably spot on, so they need to ask him how he did it.
The internal polling?
The figures he was using were sort of nearly spot on, from what I was reading a report today.
Yeah, internal polling stuff we really don't have. We never get access to, unfortunately. And that's polls that, but he really never. But Romney didn't draw a lot large crowds the entire time, and I think that's the difference. But and then that brings up another question. This isn't really technical, but how important is enthusiasm? I have from day one of Against the Norm felt that enthusiasm is what wins you an election. But again, I have no way to know if that's actually true or not. There's no formula to put in place that will give you that answer.
No, it definitely does matter, because there were a lot of...
But you don't know that. You really don't know that.
I know some Democrats that said that they are not going to go vote because they can't vote for her, but they're not going to vote for Trump. I know some that said that they're going to walk into the voting booth and hold their nose and vote for her. So there is no enthusiasm there. What are we going to do? But the again, it's using the internet and using social media to energize people is fine.
I think it worked out pretty well for him.
Yeah, but
he's got almost 15 million likes on Facebook. That says something.
Yeah.
It was funny. If you want to play this game now, anybody listening, it's not really technical or not, but go to his Facebook page and look at how many of your friends like it, and then go to hers. It's always an interesting number.
Yeah, and the shame of this is that a lot of people did not want to be known as, okay, we like him. So they will not like not follow. They will go there every day and they will read and they will feel good about it, but they will not click the follow and they will not click the like, because they did not want. And last night I was talking with Katie, and Katie is big Trump supporter, and she said that after the election this past week, she talked to some of her friends that she went to college with, that she talked on daily basis with, but they never talked about politics. Yeah. And when they found out that she is a Trump supporter, she said, I haven't heard from them yet.
Yep. Yeah, these people are at least.
So, I mean, she says, I hate this, because I thought they were good friends, and I'm sure they are. And I said, just give them time. They'll relax. It'll blow over, and you'll be back. But that's the situation. It's you, and you hear it again and again and again. And you see those people. I mean, what in the world? I mean, what was it? And at some schools, they were telling the students, if you're too stressed because of this,
Cornell,
then skip. What in the world?
Yeah. I'm not sure.
Yeah. But it was interesting, to say the least. I think it brought a lot of people together on one side or the other. It made a big divide for now still, but
Charles makes a good point, and then I guess this will be our transition. He says it maybe Hillary just sucked as a candidate, and that's why she lost. And it may not be. That is a possibility as well, Charles.
Absolutely. I mean, isn't that what's that English guy?
Nigel Farage?
No, the one that was talking about it, and he said she brought nothing.
The guy on Facebook.
Yeah.
What the hell is his name?
I can't remember his name. But that's what he said. He said, yeah, the reason is she brought nothing to the table. Yeah. It was just a continuation of nothing. This is why they went to Trump. They wanted change. And he said, a terrifying change.
Jonathan Pye was his name.
Yeah. He said, a terrifying change, but a change nevertheless. And his whole speech there, diatribe, it made sense to me too. Even though he is on her side, made a lot of sense. And he was, all of them are trying to redeem themselves by saying things that they can say these days that show that they were wrong. And there's nothing wrong about saying I was wrong, really. I mean, this is, and who knows?
And just one last thing. I think this this outcome does a lot of good for independent media. People that are in, people that are in my shoes that are doing kind of independent grassroots blogs or podcasts or whatever, because it turns out the regular mainstream media doesn't have a clue what the American people actually want and are about. So
they don't care.
There's a lot of good technical things. If you want to consider that technical, that are going to come from this election, hopefully.
Yeah, and here Nick is Nick is a big Trump supporter.
No, I'm not.
But yes, you are. But if you go to and listen to his show, Against the Norm, you will get that I'm standing aside and I'm talking about what's going on.
Well, not now. Listen to this week's, because it's a little bit different.
That was hard for you not to
before, yeah.
Yeah. It's really just talking about how things are. And it's very educating for somebody that is not into politics. But that's done. It's over. People are now, riots. Just one more thing about this. You keep hearing about the rioters. Katie yesterday showed me a ad on Craigslist, and they're all over the place, about people getting paid $1,500. And they tell, and it's organized. You can go to, on Reddit, not on, I'm sorry. And somebody posted a Craigslist ad. At this city, come to such and such, you get $1,500. And then she showed me a crumbled up a flyer that was telling people what to yell at police, what to do. And I'm saying, okay, I didn't see any of that.
No, it's all set up, of course.
It is amazing. At least, I mean, this way they're using the internet to accomplish something. Not something negative, but they are accomplishing. They're using the net for it.
I'm gonna be very interested in how sites like 538, who Nate Silver was unbelievably wrong, could not have been more wrong, about this election, how they morph and transform into the future, because something has got to change with how this polling is happening in America, because it is not accurate.
Yeah, I mean,
clearly it's not accurate.
It seems like that's the problem. It seems like,
When election day, Trump is given a 28% chance of becoming the president, and it turns out he's going to end up with over 300 electoral votes.
Yeah.
The polling is skewed, and the polling is not accurate. And we can finish it up right here. I don't think it's the fault of the people doing the polls.
No,
I really don't. I don't think they were trying to get that result. I think it's they are too disconnected from the American people, and the polling methods we have right now are not sufficient enough to judge an election in 2016. That's what I think. I don't believe it was willingly done. I don't think the result was, let's make a bunch of polls that aren't accurate. I just think they were
Time will tell. I tend to agree, but time will tell.
So we'll see.
All right.
Let's see. What else we got here?
919-518-9773. Computers2K voice on Skype.
And if you're interested in any of this stuff, check out episode 14 of Against the Norm, just up on the website now, atnshow.com.
You did that yesterday?
Last night. Did it last night around 8 o'clock. Pretty good show. I'm a little all over the place. It wasn't really organized because I was just, I didn't write anything down. I was just going off my, you know, top of my head, but it was a,
That's okay, Nick. You can do that.
But we'll be good. We'll be good for next week. So check it out. It'll also be on 2 p.m. 1 p.m. on redstatetalkradio.com as well. So there you go.
All right. If you're using FileZilla, and I know a lot of people do.
Uh-oh.
A frustrated FileZilla user took matters into his own hands after getting hacked due to the fact that his saved passwords were being saved in plain text files. Despite years of numerous requests over almost 10 years, the FileZilla devs refused to add a master password option to encrypt the stored passwords. Finally, fed up, one user forked FileZilla and created FileZilla Secure with the master password option. So if you're using FileZilla, seems like somebody created FileZilla Secure that has a master password. And it's encrypted. So this is important. I mean, when you use a... an FTP program, those spyware and some of the viruses, and I was a victim of that, I don't know, 15 years ago when I was using Qt FTP. They come in and they know which files they should look for. And the way they work said, real quick, look at this folder, and this folder, and see if there's this file and this file, grab it and send it to us. I mean, I saw what was happening on the screen, and I pulled the Ethernet wire, but it took about 10 seconds. In those 10 seconds, they grabbed that file. And so to have something that's secured, of course, if you want secured, then go and get Core FTP, Secure FTP, but these are commercial products, which I use these days. But yeah, so there's a FileZilla Secure.
Now, I believe when you believe, set up FileZilla.
I believe. Yeah.
I believe. When you set up FileZilla, there, excuse me, there is a question about security.
I don't know. I never used it.
And... because I remember one time I had to uninstall it and reset it back up because I set it up wrong and it would not save my passwords. that's really what you want. You don't want it saving your passwords. That's you talk about security. That's really what you want.
Oh, but, okay. No. Yeah, I see what you mean. That type of security. Yeah. But this is
in FileZilla. There's two options. When you set it up the first time, it asks something. Do you want to save passwords? And if you press no, it will not save and you cannot save a password
right.
on it. So.
Yeah, every file, every FTP program or SSH program is like this. The problem is I will be crazy to do that because I have an FTP configuration of about 100 different websites that I maintain, and you have to have it saved. Well, you don't have to have it saved, but it makes more sense to save it and be able to use it. Yep. Now, Yahoo is back in the news here. They announced last week a change that makes it a little easier to find the names and email addresses you want to contact in Yahoo Mail. The contact section of Yahoo Mail on desktop now lets user type in their email address for more than 200 email service providers in order to access their contacts and import them into Yahoo Mail. So you can import your contacts from 200 different email service providers into Yahoo. So up till now, apparently it was only available to import from Gmail. So if you want your people, your contacts to be famous, then import them into Yahoo. And you sort of like guarantee that they will one day end up around the world. No. This was a cheap shot at Yahoo because they admitted this week, and I thought it was admitted before, that they knew about this for 2 years. And never told their customers. The story is that earlier last week, on election day, a day absolutely guaranteed to take focus off of it, Yahoo said in a regulatory filing that it had knowledge for 2 years that a state-sponsored actor was hacking into its system. A state-sponsored actor. I guess that was the username that hacked in, right? State actor. Everybody's talking about how Russia got in, and Russia got in, and I think we're going to find out that it was maybe Russians, because Russians are good at this. Russian programmers and hackers. I don't know about the government. I don't know. Time will tell. Steve, you were going to say something? Did I?
If you're at the end of that one, I've got an interesting question.
Yeah, absolutely.
Some people here.
Yeah.
I had a reminder that my security suite antivirus and, you know, general security for computers is due for renewal next month.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to ask for people in the chat and yourself and Nick, how many computers would you say would be in an average family home that you would want to install antivirus and security on?
Two, three.
And take into account this is tablets, laptops,
tablets,
media center PCs.
How are you installing security on tablets?
Oh, if you have Windows, I guess, Surface. Oh.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, typically, regular households don't have Windows Surface tablets, right, or Windows tablets. It's typically iPads.
But you may have an iPad.
Well, yeah, but you can't install security on an iPad.
Well, you can probably, but
there's no reason to. That would be, you can't install anything, so it would make no sense to have security on that. It's got it built in.
So, you've got one teenager, and then in a family home, what would you estimate would be the average number of PCs or tablets?
To be honest with you, I know a lot of my friends that never use computers. To be perfectly honest with you, they literally just have a cell phone.
Okay.
That is their connection to the world. Well, I don't know. Two, three, four? I don't know.
Why are you asking, okay, Steve?
It's the renewal that they've sent me. I've got a renewal for four PCs.
Yeah.
What are you paying for? What software is this?
ESET Smart Security.
Oh, okay.
You've probably heard of Nod 32. It's a very popular one. It's basically part and parcel of it.
Gotcha.
But they've got a new program out called Smart Security Premium, which has got an added facility of storing passwords, a bit like LastPass or FirstPass, LastKey, whatever it's called, I don't know, which is built into it, as well as a couple of other features. To renew either what I've got currently or up to the new version of the software, they allow up to four licenses for home users. Mm-hmm. Any more than that, they categorize it as business use and whack on another £100 on the cost of it.
How many do you have?
Well, I've got a four license one at the moment, which is classed as home use.
But no. How many devices you would want to protect?
Well, I've got a desktop, a laptop, the Surface Pro, and I've just got a media center, which is Windows for the.
Okay, so you got nothing computer. So you got nothing to worry about.
But I also pay for a license for my sister, so her computer at home is safe.
Okay.
Okay, but here's the thing. What for example, why would you need to run that software on a home theater PC?
Well, why wouldn't you? Because you're not only using it in the home theater. It's connected to your telly, so you might possibly log into your email rather than picking up your laptop. You know, you want to be secure.
Yeah. I got, well, then you got to buy 5 licenses. I don't know.
Well, the thing is, Steve, instead of buying 5 licenses on one account, have 2 accounts.
Well, yeah, that's fair enough. That's the way to do it, because then it would only cost me £43 instead of £120.
Yeah.
But the point I'm trying to make is, you know, how can you deem it as being 4 and that's your maximum in this day and age?
I don't know.
People have got so many different devices connected.
Yeah.
And also, you know, teenagers have got computers in their rooms.
I don't know, Steve. I think you're in my house. I have the only 2 computers that are being used.
Okay.
Everything else is a Chromebook or an iPad. So I have my desktop and my laptop. My mother has a laptop, very rarely uses it, but my father and sister both have Chromebooks, and then everybody's got iPhones and or iPads. I'm dead serious. People really do not have computers anymore. It's really only like techie people that have computers and gamers.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's the other thing. Sometimes some people will have a gaming system and then a desktop for doing everything else, or laptop or whatever else might be. It just seemed to me that 4 was, in this day and age, was quite a low number to sort of split between home user and...
No, but
and
they want to make money.
Yeah, exactly. Well, yes, true.
And let me tell you something. Last week, 3 years ago, I paid for a Avast premium. Because there was some kind of special. It was like $39 for 3 computers for 3 years. I said, yeah, you know, they were good. It just came up for renewal. And I told them not to renew. And I went on all the machines and downgraded it to the free Avast. I mean... There was free Avast on some of the machines here, and I don't know how many machines I have here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I don't know why people want to pay for that thing when you have free products out there.
Well, I suppose it's peace of mind if you're happy with the results that you're getting and you're not getting viruses
exactly
and stuff. Then stick with the free one. But if you feel that it's necessary for you to pay a little bit and get that extra bit of security from what is the leading software provider in this field, then you pay a little bit of money.
Yeah, I'm with Amnon on this. For me, I don't see the benefit of paying for it. Now, if it was a grandparent or somebody that doesn't, you know, isn't super computer savvy and can get a virus. I mean, the reason we're using Macs and not Windows PCs at work is because my boss is an incompetent computer user and would constantly infect the computer and all of our computers on the network. And so for something like that, a paid solution would probably be the only way to do it.
Yeah.
But I mean, for me and for you, Steve, I mean, you're smart enough. I don't think you're going to, you know, go to coolfreemovies.org and, you know, infect your.
I'm sorry, just going to make a note of that address.
Got all the greatest stuff. But it's just, I don't know. It's interesting. I've never been in a situation where I felt the need to pay for it. But no, I can totally see why you would. 100%.
Peace of mind is a lot of it, isn't it? I mean, if you're not really computer savvy, or if you are computer savvy and maybe you do visit sites like that, then you need to know that what you've got is probably going to be better than the standard freebie.
Exactly.
All right. Well.
It was just something I wanted to ask. As an add-on to that, I was talking to Jorvik earlier, and he's got Trend Micro. Security suites, and he's got 5 licenses for his. So if you want 5, go with Trend. I'll probably end up switching anyway, because I very much expect an answer coming back saying tough luck, it's 4 only.
Trend Micro is a good piece of software. I mean, they're a good company. They're reputable.
Yeah, if Jorvik uses it, then I'll be happy to switch to that. He's he knows what he knows, his stuff, knows what he's doing.
Yeah. All right. Let's see what else we have here. Microsoft has developed an app that will help colorblind people see the world better. The Color Binoculars iOS app will help them differentiate between different wavelengths of color by using the iPhone's camera. Microsoft developed it just for an iPhone. I want to ask, why just for an iPhone? What's special about the iPhone camera? And why is it an app just for iPhone? But anyway, this is nice. If you can look,
well, the reason they built it for iPhone is because there's four phones on the market.
What do you mean?
It's much easier to develop for an iPhone, in which there's no discrepancy between devices. They're all the devices.
Oh, I see what you mean.
Huh? Typically, a lot of these. I mean, it's the same thing with game developers building games on consoles instead of PC, because one Xbox is the same as the next Xbox, it's the same as the next. You know, with the PC, different video card, all this and that.
Yeah,
that's typically okay. Why these more of these utility-wise apps, they always come out on iOS because it's just, I think it's just easier to develop.
All right, well, that's iPhone. And talking about iPhone, and yes. going back to Trump. Banking on Donald Trump's controversial win, Caviar just launched a gold-plated Trump iPhone as part of the luxury brand's Supremo collection. This puts Trump among the great men the collection celebrates, like Vladimir Putin and Ilham Aliyev. According to Business Insider, the Trump phone is basically an iPhone 7 that's been outfitted with a gold plate on its back as part of the luxury smartphone design, and Trump portrait is etched on the upper half of the phone, and the president-elect full name, Donald John Trump, encircles his portrait. So you can go and buy it for $3,040.
Man, if I only had a few more bucks.
Yep. I'm going to have to recycle a lot of aluminium cans for that.
Yeah, Steve, can I borrow some money?
Yeah, sure.
Steve, don't renew your antivirus. Just buy this.
Yeah.
It's worth it. Trust me.
Yeah.
This is a better investment. It's pretty good. Speaking of iPhones, I may have been won over this week. As you know, I've been very vocal against the iPhone 7.
Right.
And how I don't like there not being a headphone jack. I find it absurd. I find it ridiculous. But this week I had my phone crash and not reboot. The phone would not turn back on. And it turns out, unknowing to me, for the entire time I've had this phone, iCloud has been doing a complete and full backup of this phone online. And it was as simple as me reconfiguring the phone, doing a factory reset of the phone, logging into my iCloud account, and it downloading all of my images, contacts, messages, wallpapers, pictures, apps, app data, everything and anything.
It went back to the way it was the day before.
Correct. It went back to 9:30 p.m. on Tuesday night. This is
well. There's your cap gone then.
Wow.
What's up?
I say there's your cap gone then.
Yeah. So I don't know. That may be the single reason I go back to iOS.
Did you hear what Steve just said? I wonder how that works.
What?
He said there goes your cap, your data cap.
I mean, I did it on Wi-Fi.
Oh yeah, that's true.
But it just I could not be happier with this experience. Cause I really thought I was completely SOL. So
I mean,
I don't know.
The same thing works I think the same thing works with Android in that.
No, it doesn't.
I know that it's backing up all the time. I don't know what it's.
Maybe that's changed, but I'm not sure. But I know Brian has got the other phone I'm looking at, which is the OnePlus 3 that I'm looking at as well. So time will tell, but I gotta give a huge shout out to Apple because I didn't set iCloud up. I would have turned it off if I knew it was on, because I just don't want my stuff being constantly backed up.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, I'm glad I didn't know it was on. I guess that's what I should say, because it really, really saved my behind.
Well, I mean, if you really don't want your stuff to be out there backed up all the time, then you may be able to turn it off now and just...
Well, I don't want to turn it off now. I mean, the reason I mean,
how often do you change things on the...
Well, it backs up everything. Text messages, images. I mean, it backs everything up. I'm fine that it's backing...
Okay.
That it's backing things up. I was just...
All right. In that case, never mind.
Surprised.
Well, it's nice to be pleasantly surprised like that instead of completely devastated.
Exactly, which is what I was going towards when I realized I had lost all my stuff. But yeah, I got to give a big props to Apple there, because it's flawless.
Props, 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 props.
There you go.
Okay, let's see what else comes up here. Google is adding a new weapon to its safe browsing arsenal to fight back against dodgy websites. As of Tuesday, sites can be labeled as repeat offenders if they repeatedly switch between operating a clean site and one filled with malware or unwanted software. Why would a website do that? Simple. Scrupulous sites can make money with deceptive practices such as forcing unsuspecting downloads on users. Eventually, Google flags these sites as unsafe, which reduces the traffic since users get a giant red warning sign in their browsers with no obvious way to continue. And I'm sure a lot of people seen this. To get around that problem, sites clean up their act, apply to Google to get the site warning lifted, and then once the warning is gone, the malware or unwanted software returns. So now they're going to mark them repeat offenders and leave them like that for 30 days. I guess that, again, time will tell how that tactic works, but anything should work. We say it again, I mean, be careful what you're downloading from the internet. Be careful what pop-ups you click on. Don't be complacent. If you see a pop-up comes up, look at it, read it, try to understand it. And be proactive and participate in the way that your computer is trying to tell you something or not trying to tell you something because somebody's telling it, shut up and just do what I'm telling you to do. It's a big money maker, and they're arresting people left and right overseas. We're talking millions and millions of dollars. And it's again, if you see a pop-up that tells you that you're infected, first thing, read the title bar of that pop-up. But, of course, that's not going to help you if you don't know which antivirus you're using. The only thing that can tell you that you need to scan because you have a virus is your antivirus program. So it will say on the title bar of the pop-ups that it's Avast or Security Essentials or whichever. And if that's not what it is, don't click the X. Don't click the close. Because to explain it in a simple way, the X and the close button or the cancel button are all programmed to do what you think they will be doing. But if it is a trap, just like you would cover a trap in the forest with leaves, that's what they do here. They give you the chance to close or to cancel or to X. But really, when you click on it, there is language behind it that tells it, oh, they click the X, that means they want to exit. Well, the programmer can put, oh, they click the X, that means they tell you, go ahead and install the malware. So the best way is to actually control all delete. I mean, if you're not technical, and I know we have a lot of people that are listening who are not technical, switch the machine off. Just reach for the button, power button, and switch it off. Yes, you're taking a chance of corrupting some things, but better than corrupting the whole drive. When it comes
and
up...
And also as a precaution, when you switch back on again, if you go into your browser and it should come up and say something like browser did not close properly, right. Do you want to restore last session? Say no.
Absolutely. So this is the safe way of doing, and at that point, Don't even start your browser. I will not start my browser. I would go and you can download CCleaner. And when you come back, just run it and clean the drive, which will remove all the temporary files and junk files from all the browsers. Because unless you told it to install the culprit, it's sitting in your cache, in your cache folder, and you want that cleaned up. If you are technical, then control all delete, go to task manager, and close the browser, end the task. And do the same thing, clean the drive. So CCleaner is a free program. Now, don't play around with it and do the registry and all that if you don't know what you're doing. Just run Cleaner, which all it does is removes the junk files. And once it cleans it up, then open your browser again. But always the main thing is look. It's just like when you install programs. Look at those little screens that come up and open up. Many programs will try to install other programs along with it. It's a free program. They don't want to just give it to you. There's something behind the scenes that they want to do. So companies pay the money. Say, okay, you know, I will give you so many dollars for every time somebody install a program. So many programs you will see, it's also going to install this and this, and you need to uncheck these. So you can't just go next, 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 next.
Sometimes you need to go into either custom or advanced to see these checkboxes so you can uncheck them.
If you have that, then do that. I see so many computers over here with programs that have no business being on the computer. I mean, they're not spyware. I'm not saying that they're spyware or viruses, although they could be. In most cases, it's things that you really don't need that just take over and do things that you don't want them to do. Interact with your computer. No, I don't want, all I want is this program and that's it. So it's the same thing with those pop-ups. Make sure it's the correct program that is notifying you of that problem. In most cases, it will be it sounds like it's a virus scanner that's telling you, oh, you have so many infections. Read and see which program is telling you this. But without you knowing which antivirus program you have, it's worthless. Because if you see a disk optimizer telling you that, and they're good at making it look just like it's a Windows program, like the system, you need to know which is your antivirus, which one is your anti-malware, and if it says that you're infected, it needs to be your antivirus, nothing else. And if it's something else, you know that you got something on your drive at this point that could harm you. And that's why turn it off or control alt delete. Aye.
Either it'll harm you or it'll just get in the way and be a nuisance.
Yeah,
like
right.
Alan says in the chat, my friend one time installed 10 or more toolbars. Luckily, none was malware.
Right, exactly. It'll slow your machine down. It'll make you less... It's less practical to have a browser window that has, like Steve says, a bunch of toolbars, because every toolbar takes away from your real estate. And you want to have as much as you can. 919-518-9773, Computers 2K Voice on Skype. Aren't you using Spotify, Steve?
I tried it once, wasn't impressed.
Okay.
I like music from the 80s and 90s. I'm not really into trying to find new music, because most of the new music I hear, if I happen to have the radio on, is pants.
So as one of the most popular music streaming services in the world, Spotify is installed on millions of PCs and Macs. But users may want to temporarily uninstall the app after Ars Technica reported it contains a bug that has been writing gigabytes worth of data into users' storage devices. Ars found that the Spotify app can write as much as 5 gig to 10 gig of data an hour to a drive, and can accumulate up to 700 gig of junk when the app is left running for more than a day. This occurs even when the app is idle and no songs are stored locally. While this junk data obviously takes up precious storage space, it can also dramatically erode the lifespan of a drive, especially solid states. Users have posted a few manual methods of dealing with the issue, but they require some legwork. Spotify has supposedly fixed things in version 1.0.42 of the app, which is rolling out now. If it's not yet arrived, you may want to delete the app and use the service through the browser player until it does. So if you have Spotify and you have it installed on your machine, if it's not 1.0.42, uninstall the app. I don't know how it may clean the drive automatically. I mean, you may need to check and see how much disk space you're using. If you see that you suddenly use a lot of disk space, that may be the problem. And it's a bug. It's not something that they did maliciously.
Well, uninstall it, reboot, and run CCleaner and see what drive space is different.
Yeah, you can do that. Right. Is Nick
back? I read this week, actually, Firefox is doing something very similar.
What do you mean?
On Dave's computer tips. I haven't got the specific details, yeah. But Firefox was doing something very similar to that. That's gigabytes a day.
Yeah, in order to be able to restore pages.
Yeah, if you should crash, to bring you back to where you were, it can be gigabytes of data a day.
Right.
Or an hour, I should say.
Yeah. It's no fun. It slows you down when it does that.
But it's nice that they've got security things like that, but not when it's going to ruin your SSD. Have to spite your face, aren't you, in that respect?
They have only so many writes that they can perform before they go bad. And when they do this, it's like months of you using the computer in a normal way can happen in an hour of something like this happening. So, yeah, be very, very careful. Who's got a Wii U?
I do.
You do?
Yep.
Sales for the Wii U have been falling for a while now, and
they never started to fall. They never got high enough to fall, unfortunately.
Oh, well, that's how the article goes. And Nintendo has finally announced it intends to end production of the system months before launching its follow-up, the Nintendo Switch. An announcement on the Wii U Japan site notes that production of the Wii U will be ending in that country. And if Nintendo is killing the hardware off in its most popular country, it isn't going to keep the U.S. version going for long either. So, I mean, that doesn't say that the Wii U is not continuing to work.
No, but it's going to be replaced in March.
Yeah, they're going to have a new system. But if you have it, you can still use it.
Correct. Well, nobody does, unfortunately. I bought it Thanksgiving a year ago.
Uh-huh.
And I've literally used it three times.
Why? I mean, what did you expect that you didn't get?
I didn't expect anything. I was just in the moment. It was a good deal. It was too good of a deal to pass up.
Oh.
It's just a pain to use.
Huh.
No.
Because of the exercise. That's why.
No, the Wii U is nothing like the Wii. This is the...
So it's not something that you stand in front of?
No, this is the Wii U controller.
Yeah.
It's not like the Wii with the little chuck thing. But it's just, the more and more I play computer games, I just tend to not turn on other systems because it's just a pain. Got to switch the HDMI over. Got to have a controller charged up. Got to have power plugged in for that. Got to find a disc to plug in a game. It's just all this garbage and all this nonsense.
Okay.
It's just annoying. I mean, it's a total first world problem, but it's just annoying.
All right, that's a good reason.
Because I'm an idiot, I'll be buying the new one in March as well. So look forward to that.
Well, you're a gamer.
Yeah, but it's only useful for you if you play it.
No.
Whatever, life goes on.
Yep. Apple again.
Mm-hmm.
What happened to your video?
I'm eating.
Oh. Apple started selling refurbished iPhones on its website. They're available with a 1-year warranty. Apple also sells refurbished Macs, iPads, and iPods. But at Apple, the iPhone is king. In Apple's most recent quarter, 60% of revenue came from the iPhone, and Apple has sold more than 1 billion, with a B, iPhones since the company came out with the first edition of the phone in 2007. So you can buy a refurbished iPhone from their website, and it has a one-year warranty. What kind of warranty does it normally have?
Three, I believe. Two.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, it's still a good, if the prices are good.
They said they're now selling these on their website?
Yeah.
Look at this, because
they started selling refurbished iPhones on its website. Why? You're going to get the 7? No, you're not going to get a 7. I know you're not.
I mean, if the price is right. Wow. They've got a 6S.
Yeah.
And these aren't the plus. I'd like a plus.
Well, how much is it?
I'm looking for the one I'm looking for. Hold on. Six plus 500 bucks.
And what is it normally?
To buy the phone new is probably 800, 900.
Okay, yeah. So it is a good, yeah.
It's not good enough of a deal though for me. Personally.
Well, I mean, for somebody who's going to buy a 6 plus
you new, know, yes and no.
Why?
Oh, because you can't do any of the payment plans with this, which everybody loves to do.
With
it's a, I don't know, it's a good deal, but at the same point, I mean, maybe not. Go to their website and look.
So is Facebook service, is that a racist thing?
Facebook is very racist, yes.
Facebook will no longer allow ads based on ethnic affinity.
Bunch of morons.
In 3 advertising areas, we are going to turn off, actually prohibit, the use of ethnic affinity marketing for ads that we identify as offering housing, employment, and credit. The company told the publication, the company said in a statement that it will require advertisers to make new agreements to not discriminate with ads and is planning to release new material to help advertisers understand their obligations. So apparently they had ads targeted at blacks, they hit ads.
I mean, isn't the whole point of advertising to target a group of people?
Well, yeah, but apparently that it's not cool to do that. That's, I mean, remember,
you got to be progressive, man.
Yeah, you got to. But it's interesting that they do that.
I mean, is it literally the whole point of advertising to actively go after a group of people?
Yeah.
But that totally defeats the point of advertising.
Well.
Right?
It can. Yeah, it can.
Well, just think about it. If a advertisement is trying to go after middle-aged white women, that's the whole point of advertising, is to go after a group of people. I mean, that just doesn't make any sense.
It we'll see how that plays out, because that may just be
that may only a matter of time before they crumble.
No, I don't know. I mean, it's kind of hard to crumble a company like that.
Oh, I don't know. They've been constantly shooting themselves right in the foot.
Yeah, and that's what I'm saying. This whole thing here may be just the way to tell the world, okay, yeah, we're going to we're redeeming ourselves. We're straightening out or whatever, and really they're not. Because really, they want the money. And if advertisers are going to say, okay, never mind, they will have to come back.
True.
I was so close the other day to call one of the restaurants, local restaurants, and order takeout. And say, oh, using Grubhub. No, never mind. Forget it.
Nope, never mind. Neither am I. Well, it's a good story.
Yeah, it's very, very good story. Although they were trying to spin it The thing was that the CEO of Grubhub, the story also went that over the past 24 hours, and this was on Wednesday, top executives at Apple, eBay, Box, LinkedIn, Microsoft sent company-wide memos urging employees to try to move forward and expressing the belief that people are inherently good. Others like Facebook, Mark Zuckerberg, have posted public statements about having to find new ways to work together. It's kind of messaging that the company leader would send after natural disasters, an attack on the station, on the nation, or a looming crisis within the company. This was obviously about Trump. Grubhub, the CEO, sent out a message that he doesn't support any of Trump's ideas, that he, the main thing was that he was saying that the transgenders, or, you know, people that are working for them, that he will do everything to support them and to fight for them and blah, blah, blah. And then it says, and if you don't like this, then please submit your resignation. That we don't want people like you in the company. And it sounds like, and I think that's how it was, and maybe I'm wrong, that he said, if you don't like my ideas about all this, then resign. Because we're going to be like that. Then they spun it to say that what he actually meant is, we will continue to fight and protect you, those that are the minorities and those that are the quote-unquote suffering from that whole thing. And he meant to say the others, if you don't like what I'm saying here, then resign. So if you don't like me saying that we will protect and this and that and the other, then resign. Not if you don't believe what I'm saying. It can be understood. I mean, I went and read it again. And I said, well, yeah, somebody could say that. But I think they're seeing a backlash. That's backlash to what he wrote. And that's why they were spinning it now. There are companies that are going to suffer from being a certain way. This always amazed me that companies will take one side or another when they have both type of people, no matter what they are. Black and white, gay and straight, women, men, whatever it is, will take one side or the other or seem to. What is wrong with just putting everybody in one pot? It's the same thing, and I'm getting back on the ideology thing here. Everybody wants to say, oh, we want to be equal. Well, if you want to be equal, then stop doing things just for that group or just for that group. You yourself need to. So these companies here are going to probably suffer some for a while. But it's you would think that they would learn from that and they will not do it again. That doesn't happen. I don't know why. Steve, are you back? He's not. There's a story here, but the UK will wait for Steve. Nick.
Sorry, I'm back, but it's breaking up a bit.
Okay. Yeah, there is a story here that 1,000 schools across the UK are monitoring children classroom activities through surveillance software, according to a new report released by privacy advocate group Big Brother Watch. The paper claimed that schools have spent an estimated £2.5 million which is $3.1 million, on monitoring solutions to keep an eye on pupils. That's not pupils here. Pupils are what students are called in real English.
Students.
The technology known as classroom management software tracks computer usage, including student internet activity, browser history, and even keyboard strokes. The report finds that 70% of secondary schools in Britain have installed monitoring systems across more than 800,000 school-owned devices and near to 1,500 privately owned devices. Is this something new in it? Do you know anything about this?
I hadn't heard anything about it, but it doesn't surprise me with the UK government.
Yeah, but 1,500 privately owned devices. I mean, it's not just on their computers. So it's an interesting...
Surveillance is going mad, isn't it?
I mean, I don't see anything wrong about doing it at school when you want to make sure that kids don't go to porn sites. Of course, they can solve it with a proxy, and there's no way to go there.
Well, David Cameron was pretty heavy on trying to save the children.
Yeah. And?
Well, he would try to instigate all sorts of different locks and filters and surveillance and stuff like that to, as I say, save the children. You mentioned that phrase and everybody's, oh, yeah, we must put something in place.
Hmm. Okay. Well, it's an interesting situation. It's a lot of money, and the techie kids can probably get over it. Can get around it too.
Probably, yeah. I mean, you only want a VPN, and you can circumvent all these blocks.
Yeah. Is anybody following what's going on in the chat? I'm just wondering. LinkedIn. The story goes that rejecting an appeal from the company, a Moscow municipal court confirmed today an earlier court decision to consider LinkedIn as violating the Russian legislation on personal data storage. According to Russian news agency Interfax, as a consequence, the telecom regulator Roskomnadzor, which had initiated the legal procedure against LinkedIn, will require operators to block access to the site from Russia. This may happen as early as next week, according to their spokesman, Vladimir and Pelpovsky. They're going to block LinkedIn. I couldn't read enough. I mean, enough to understand what they're talking about, unless you go and read the whole political thing about decision about storage. But I would think that they are talking about something that LinkedIn is keeping stuff stored in on servers, and it's easy to break in and all that, but it's not easy to change. I mean, LinkedIn cannot just say, okay, well, yeah, we can just go ahead and switch this and do it in a different way. I also don't know how big LinkedIn is in Russia, so it's an interesting situation. I wonder what we're going to block here now in the United States. All right, Nick.
What's up?
Listen to this. The Canadian Broadcasting Corporation, CBC, publishes several excellent podcasts. And like every podcast in the world, these podcasts are available via any podcast app in the same way that all web pages can be fetched with a web browser. This being the entire point of podcasts. In a move of breathtaking, lawless ignorance, the CBC has begun to send legal threats to podcast app makers, arguing that making an app that pulls down public RSS feeds in a commercial use is a violation of the public broadcaster's copyrights. This is a revival of an old dark era in the web's history when linking policies prevailed, through which publishers argued that they had the right to control who could make a link to their sites. That is, who could state the public true fact that a page exists at this address. But the CBC is going once worse here. Their argument is that making a tool that allows someone to load a public URL without permission is violating copyright law. It's the same thing as saying because Google is a for-profit corporation, anytime a Chrome user loads a CBC page in the Chrome browser without the CBC permissions, Google is violating CBC's copyright. We hope it was all an accidental mistake from the CBC because it seems like a very stupid thing to do otherwise. RSS.
They're Canadian. What do you expect?
But I mean, come on. They're also, you know, Canadians are not stupid.
I don't know. I'm moving there, so I'll find out soon.
Yeah, if all the those people that said that they're going to move there, then they're going
You can go download the CBC podcast. Good luck to you.
It's just amazing that they would say that if you're writing an app that downloads RSS feeds from anywhere, then you're breaking copyright rules.
Yeah, I don't think that's how that works.
Yeah. No, of course it doesn't work. That's not the way it works, but that's what they're saying. It is interesting. What else? And Alan is saying, doesn't the BBC do that already? I don't know.
You were breaking up for me, so I didn't hear some of what you were saying. Unfortunately, I didn't get the gist of it.
Oh, that they are. Do you want to refresh?
Yeah, I'll do a computer restart.
No. Just refresh.
Browser restart.
Just refresh. Yeah, just refresh your browser.
Okay.
Let's see if that fixes it. Doom, 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 doom. Yeah, 919-518-9773, Computer Stuke Voice on Skype. Come on, guys. I mean, I don't have any more actual stories.
End the show. So then we can end the show.
Yeah, we can end the show. It's fine.
I can talk about the Cyclone Mini PC 2 dongle that I bought briefly, if you like.
Yeah, a what?
It's by SunVision. You remember some months ago I tried a SunVision sort of little box that fixes into your HDMI connector. Well, they brought out a new one now called the SunVision Cyclone Mini PC dongle version 2, which is a heck of a lot smaller. It comes with a USB port and a USB 3 port, a little plug-in power adapter that plugs into a USB, standard USB mini type socket to power it.
Mm-hmm.
Wireless, and it's also got an Ethernet plug on it as well, a socket on it as well, I should say. It's quite a compact little device, about the size of an average biggish smartphone these days. Bit thicker, obviously. It works very well. It's got Windows 10 on it. You can buy it with 2 gig of RAM or 4 gig of RAM. The one I got was with 4 gig of RAM. It's reasonably responsive. It's got the new version 5 processor up to 1.83 hertz, whatever that is. I don't know. I can't remember the specific terminology for it. I think I linked to it last week or the week before when I got it. I've had some major problems with it in respect of graphics drivers. I installed it. It worked right for a couple of days, and then I contacted their support. I had to download the ISO and reinstall from scratch. Mm-hmm. But Windows was having a problem. When Windows updated, it was updating the graphics software, which then just left you with a blank screen. They recommended leaving it for 2 or 3 hours to see if it would finish doing the updates. But I was still left with a blank screen, so I left it overnight. So it was on for, I don't know, about 12 hours, say. And I still came down in the morning to a blank screen. So I deduced that it was the graphics drivers that were the problem. After, I think, 3 reinstalls, I eventually decided to do the graphics driver last. And touch wood, at the moment it's all working okay, but initially it was very frustrating trying to get the thing going. Some vision support was very good, very apologetic that I'd sort of suffered this kind of aggravation with it, and suggested that I try one more time, and if get any problems to get back to them. But say touch wood, it seems to be all right at the moment. And it's quite a nice little device for something that connects to your TV that you just want to do a bit of browsing with, maybe check your emails, and uses a basic media center type thing on your television screen. It's quite good for the price.
Again, how much was it?
You can pick them up for about £155.
Hmm.
I got mine quite a bit cheaper than that, but... yeah, I mean, you can install whatever you like. It's a 32 gigabyte solid state drive that's built into it, which is more than enough for Windows 10. But you can install, you know, whatever Thunderbird, whatever software you like onto it, and it's a Windows 10 PC, but it's in the size of a thick smartphone.
Interesting.
Quite a neat little device, but it's much better than the other system, which was a box. Whereas this is just like a thin sliver of metal.
Good. Very nice. Very, very nice. Well, I mean, talking about playing something through a TV, I've never done it until last night. Last Friday, we went to a local retirement home to where there are a lot of vets in the North Carolina Vietnam vets group showed a recording of a play that was done 2 years ago called Etchings in Stone, which is the story of the wall. I was always there with a vehicle, so I could never go in and watch it. I didn't see the play itself, the live, and I didn't, over here, I couldn't see the recording. So Ron gave me a thumb drive with the video on it. And I wanted to play it yesterday on our big TV in the living room. So now I'm going to have to bring a machine here and connect it to the computer, to the TV and all that. And Katie was sitting there and said, well, why don't you put it into the TV? Isn't that a smart TV? I said, yes. She said, well, just put it in a USB port. I said, oh. So I put it there. Sure enough, it came up and it says, which one, what do you want to play? I said, videos. And there it was. And you just click. This was amazing. I mean, we're learning as we go. It was very easy to use and do it. So if you have a movie that they recorded, I mean, if it was a CD, it would be a problem. But because it was on a thumb drive, it was real simple to do. I guess you could put a portable CD player or DVD player and plug it into USB and do the same thing. I still need to put a computer on the TV so we can go and watch other stuff. I can't stand any of those apps that are on the TV to go and watch YouTube or because you have to use it's excruciatingly hard to get somewhere when you have to use a keyboard that is not.
Yeah, they don't make it easy. I mean, it's nice to have it there, but it's certainly not a simplified process, is it? Unless you can plug a wireless keyboard into your
I tried. TV. I plugged the wireless keyboard. It doesn't work the way that they say. It's jumping all over the place. It's doing things. I don't know. It's not something we do a lot.
Mine did in the smart TV, because I got the 4K smart TV recently. The Logitech wireless keyboard and mouse, which is like all in one unit, a K400, I think it is. That did work. But the apps that are built into it are so laborious and like, oh, I've got to wait for this to load up. But having a PC in it, even if it's one of these little PC dongles, makes it far, far more fluid.
Yeah. I just never knew that it would be that easy.
If it's an AVI file, it probably will play in most smart TVs.
Yeah.
Or MP4.
It was an MP4, and it came right up. All right, guys. Is there anybody in the chat that wants to ask any questions, to direct us in a different direction? Dum, 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 dum. I guess not. All right. Okay, then. We'll end the show. Thanks again, Steve, Nick, everybody.
John's got a question here. What antivirus do you guys use?
Oh.
Eastlet Smart Security for me at the moment. Might change.
Yeah, I use Avast, and now I use Avast Free. I don't think Nick uses any.
Nope. Whatever's built in by default.
Yeah. And yeah, with Windows 10, I mean, you have Defender, and Defender is like, it's actually supposedly better than Security Essentials or the same.
Yeah.
So it's fine. What do you use, John? Is it something that that you're trying to switch from? Windows Defender, yeah. With Windows 10, you're fine there. But if you're on Windows 7, you need to get something.
If you wanted to get something that you want to pay for to have a bit of extra peace of mind, ESET Nod 32 is consistently in the top 10. Or if not the top one,
type it in, Steve.
I'll type it in for you. Yeah.
Yeah. Malwarebytes is different. I mean, if you're running Malwarebytes in a resident mode, like it's loaded all the time, you're also slowing down your computer big time. Okay, so you can actually, how can you, I thought these things, what do you mean, you can buy them cheaper? Some people sell it for cheaper, that's interesting. Not resident, good, yeah. Yeah, and you run it like once a week, and same thing with CCleaner. Yesterday, again, Steve mentioned Dave's computer tips. He was talking about, what is that anti-malware that he was talking about? Oh, shoot, I forgot the name of it. Go to Dave's computer tips and subscribe to his newsletter. Very good information there. I'm trying to say Zarian. It's not Zarian. It's Zamara, something like this. It's also you can get for free. And sort of like Malwarebytes. You can get super anti-spyware, the free version, and also run it every now and then. Advanced System Care is pretty good, but it seems like I remember a long time ago, I had some problems with it. Oh, no, it was using a lot of resources. It's huge. But anything, you can't use enough. If you don't use them in resident mode, so meaning they're not down there, they're not loaded in memory all the time, then you can use as many of them as you want, and it's fine because some will find things that others will not. And you just, you know, say, okay, once a week, twice a week, I just sit for about 10 minutes and I run this program and this program and this program and this program, one after another, until they clean everything, and I keep working until next time I do it. That's sort of like what I do. All right. So again, thanks everybody in the chat. Steve, Nick. And good morning, Kathy, Hannah, Nabil, Mac, Norm, Katie and Donna. Thank you everybody for tuning to Computers 2K Now. We hope you enjoyed and maybe learned something from our time together. Remember to practice safe computing, back up your hard drive, update your virus scanner. We'll be back here next Sunday at 9. But you can always reach us at computers2know.com. While you're at it, like us on Facebook and follow our YouTube channel. At noon today, it's the Gisela Show. And tomorrow at 1 o'clock, it is Breaking Free. So go out there, enjoy your week, and remember, let's make America great again.
You're tuned to the Nissan Communications Network. Our weekly lineup of call-in programs includes Computers 2K Now with Amnon Nissan, My Life, My Will with Gisela DiCarlo, The Tanya Love Show, Help Thin with Debbie Brooke, Breaking Free with Marilyn Shannon, Triangle Be Well with Howard Jacobson, Lunch and Learn with Rabbi Yisrael Cutler, Lessons of Vietnam with NCVVI members, Current Affairs with Amnon Nissan. And if you tuned in too late, you can always watch each program in its entirety or download an MP3 audio file of it in the archives section on nissancommunications.com. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel, follow us on Twitter, and like us on Facebook. Sponsored by Atomos.com, makers of quality video recorders and converters, CarolinaApparel.com, and DeltaForce.net.